63 years ago, on the morning of April 12, 1961, Yuri Gagarin fell out of the sky onto a collective farm on the Volga River. He unhooked his parachute and strolled, waving, toward a woman and her 5-year-old granddaughter who were weeding a potato patch. A calf was tethered near them. All three of them stood still and stared as he approached. Born on a collective farm himself, Gagarin took care not to frighten them. He took off his helmet to show them his smiling face and called out that he was a friend so they could hear him speaking Russian. "Have you come from outer space?" the woman asked him. "As a matter of fact, I have," he answered with a grin. And then, because his radio had broken and he needed to report in, he asked where the nearest telephone was. She didn't seem to know. The first human being to go into space couldn't report his achievement because he couldn't find a phone. Gagarin's happy-go-lucky manner belied how fraught with danger his flight was. Just a few minutes earlier, he'd been in serious trouble. The Soviet space program had just snatched an historic victory from the jaws of catastrophe, as it often did. The Soviet space program's stunning early successes, Sputnik's flight in 1957, Gagarin's in 1961, look all the more remarkable now that we know how very ramshackle the program was. While trumpeting their undeniable victories, the Soviets hid their many failures. Poorly funded, squabbling for supplies, and constantly hurried by ignorant political figures, Soviet scientists and engineers jerry-rigged rockets and space vehicles that were extremely hazardous and sometimes deadly. The world only learned what a Potemkin space program it was in the 1990s, after the fall of the USSR. The capsule that carried Gagarin into space, called Vostok, was like a large BB pellet, more space ordnance than spacecraft. The Soviets built an enormous rocket to thrust it into orbit, but had no confidence they could bring it safely back to Earth. American astronauts softly splashed down in temperate waters. But because of their obsession with secrecy, the Soviets built their cosmodrome, their equivalent of Cape Canaveral, out in the middle of the remote Kazakhstan desert, and their space vehicles banged down on solid ground hard enough to kill the occupants. So Gagarin and other early cosmonauts ejected from the plummeting spheres, like fighter pilots ejecting from damaged planes, and parachuted to the ground. Typical of the Soviet space program, it was a workaround as desperate as it was ingenious. Also typical, they lied about it, claiming the cosmonauts and capsules landed together. Gagarin blasted off at 9:07 a.m. on April 12th. At 79 minutes into its flight, Vostok was arcing smoothly over West Africa when the engineers on the ground triggered the retro rockets to brake for re-entry. The rockets burned as planned, and then things went very wrong. Gagarin reported the next day that, quote, "As soon as the braking rockets shut off, there was a sharp jolt, and the craft began to rotate about its axis at a very high velocity. Everything was spinning around." Behind the Vostok sphere that held Gagarin was an equipment module with braking rockets, oxygen tanks, batteries. This was supposed to detach when the retro rockets cut off. It had not. A thick cord of electrical cables kept them, quote, "tied together like a pair of boots with their laces inadvertently knotted," Jamie Duran and Piers Beeseny write in Starman, their biography of Gagarin. The whole ensemble tumbled end over end in its headlong rush to Earth. If the two modules collided as they lurched around, Gagarin would likely be killed. Vostok was weighted so that its heat shielding would face downward during re-entry, but the attached unit kept the capsule from orienting properly. So Vostok was a fireball, pitching and yawing uncontrollably. Gagarin could feel the intense heat and hear the hull crackling, his vision blurred as heavy G-forces slammed him around. Then came a bit of luck. The cables burned through, and the capsules broke away from the rocket pack. Unfortunately, that made it start spinning so violently that Gagarin nearly blacked out. The indicators on the instrument panels went fuzzy, and everything seemed to go gray, he'd report. As the capsule dropped through denser air, the fire burned out, and the spinning eased somewhat. Gagarin could see blue sky out the charred porthole before he ejected. As he floated to the ground, he had no idea how lucky he was that his parachute even opened. Later, it would come to light that the engineer in charge of testing cosmonaut parachutes failed to either report or fix a problem with them snagging on an antenna as they deployed. 2 days later, an airliner set down at Moscow's Vnukovo Airport. Gagarin came down the steps and then began a long march across a red carpet laid on the tarmac from the plane to a reviewing stand, where a beaming Nikita Khrushchev awaited him. As Gagarin approached, some in the crowd gasped and stared. The long laces of one of his officer's boots had come untied and were flapping behind him. The tension that sight produced, that the first human to soar around the world might trip over his own bootlaces, in a way sums up the Soviet space program. A small echo of the bootlaces of cables that had tied his capsule to his equipment pod and almost killed him. Yuri Gagarin went on to be the USSR's first global celebrity, dent his face in a drunken fall, and die in a mysterious plane crash. The Soviet space program, meanwhile, racked up some truly horrific catastrophes, including a monstrous launch pad explosion that killed as many as 165 people, and a fiery reentry that left a cosmonaut burned to a lump unrecognizable as human. Very little of this was admitted in public until after the Soviet Union itself crashed and burned.